Good afternoon, Westport Baptist Church.
Hi, can I speak to the pastor, please?
May I ask who's calling?
Yeah, this is Nathaniel.
Nathaniel?
Yes, ma'am. I'm actually calling out of state. I've just got a question in regards to the book of Genesis. I'm a follower of Christ, and I have been reading Genesis, and I figured a pastor would be the most qualified to help me out. I've just got one question about a particular verse. I definitely don't want to waste anyone's time.
Okay, all right. Hold on just a minute, please.
Thank you.
Uh-huh.
Hello?
Hey, sir.
Hello.
Hey, my name is Nathaniel. How you doing?
I'm doing well. Hope you are.
I'm doing great, sir. I'm doing great. I was telling the receptionist I definitely don't want to take up too much of your time. I've just got a particular question about the biblical definition of a word that I'm seeing in the book of Genesis. So if you've got just a moment, I read the King James Version, and while reading Genesis chapter 1, verse 6, it states that God placed a firmament in the midst of the waters. Now, I'm just curious on the biblical definition of that term, and I felt that a pastor would be the most qualified to help me out.
Okay, read it again.
So Genesis chapter 1, verse 6, it says that God put a firmament in the midst of the waters to divide the waters from the waters.
Right. The word firmament literally just means the dome shape of the sky.
Okay. So
it's a division between the heavens and the earth.
I got
you. Waters and the waters.
Waters and the waters. So when it says that there's water above the firmament, what does that mean exactly? Because I know there's water in, you know, the sky, but I don't think there's water above the sky. And I'm just really curious as to what that means.
Well, it's a good question. One I've never really thought about a whole lot. Why are you asking? What is the purpose of your inquiry?
Well, I'm actually just really interested in capturing the visualization of that depiction, because I'm aware that Genesis, you know, is the story of creation, and I'm just trying to wrap my head around, like I said, that visualization of that portion of Scripture. I'm a follower of Christ. I've been, reading the Bible for about 3 years now.
Right.
But, man, well, I appreciate all your time, Pastor.
Well, I wish I could be more help. So you're Genesis chapter 1, verse 6, right? Is that what you said?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah, that's a good question as far as exactly what it means, dividing the waters from the waters. As it goes on to say that he called the firmament heaven in verse 8.
Right. It's really a stumbling block that I've encountered within, you know, the past couple of days. Like I said, man, you know, I really appreciate
you. The literal definition of firmament is the dome shape of the sky. The word that's translated firmament literally means like the dome shape of the sky. You go out at night and you look up and you can see the dome shape of the sky. That's the literal definition of that word in the Hebrew. But as far as exactly what he meant by the division of the waters and the waters, I'll be honest with you, I'm not sure.
Okay, Pastor. Well, man, you know, like I said, I appreciate you taking my call and, you know, spending the time to at least try to help. So that means a lot to me.
Well, you're welcome.
All right, brother. You have a great day.
You too.
Bye-bye.
A couple of years ago, I was asked to do a Bible study group. I'm thinking Catholics don't do Bible studies, you know. Mm-hmm. And to do a Bible study group in Houston. I mean, Catholics definitely don't do Bible studies in Texas. to do a Bible study group in Houston with a bunch of astronauts. Astronauts, oh, I could do that, yeah. So I wound up at a dinner evening of about 12 couples, all of them astronauts and spouses. One of the guys, half of them were Catholic, as it turns out, so much for Catholics not doing Bible studies. One of the guys came up to me and said, you know, I just want to let you know, I believe in the absolute truth that creation was made in the 6 days, just as described in the book of Genesis, and that's my religion. I just want to let you know that ahead of time. And I'm thinking, you know, have you actually read Genesis, where it says the world is flat and it's covered with a dome and there's water above and below the dome? You know, where does the shuttle go? How come you don't get wet?
Hey, Kathy, this is Nathaniel. I was told to call back within the next 30 minutes to speak with the priest.
Okay, just one moment, please. Let me see if he's available.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi, Nathaniel, this is Father Matthew.
Hey, Father.
What can I do for you?
Yeah, man, so I definitely don't want to take up too much of your time. I've been reading the Bible here. I've got the New American Revised Edition. Do you have a copy of the New American Bible by chance?
I do, not in front of me at the moment, but I'm familiar with it.
Okay, good. Well, just opening up, you know, the first page in Genesis chapter 1, verse 6. I'm going to go ahead and dive right into it, man. It says, and God said, let there be a dome in the middle of the waters to separate one body of water from the other. Do you happen to know, or maybe you can shed some light on why that translation was used, either at the time of the translation or, you know, maybe, you know, what the writers were thinking?
So for the New American in particular, as opposed to which translation? King James or something else?
Well, any. It's just a striking term, I guess, if I'm thinking.
For dome?
Exactly.
Yeah, oh, okay. Yeah, well, I mean, Genesis is a little bit mysterious in some ways. If you keep reading through Genesis, the way God is depicting the creation and the beginning of the earth, it doesn't actually ever rain until Noah's Ark. So it seems like he put some sort of, I guess, dome, if you want to say, or something by his power, his grace, to prevent water from falling from the sky, to mark a separation. But I couldn't tell you why they use that word. That I don't know.
Okay. This is interesting. Like I said, I thought the priest would be most qualified to help me out, especially with this translation. New American. So you don't know why dome was used?
No. And at the moment, I don't remember what word was there for the Hebrew. But I think it probably is there mainly to emphasize the distinction and the separation. But I don't know why they use that word. No, sorry.
Yeah. I think when I think of a dome, man, you know, I think of I don't know, like the NFL or something. Anyway.
Yeah. And the way that it's depicted in Genesis 2, people thought it was a flat, right? And that the dome would have been like a dome across a flat space, as opposed to being a globe.
I'm sorry, could you say that last part again?
Yeah, sure. The way people thought about Genesis 4 before they understood the world was round was they thought of it as flat, right? And so I think dome probably made more sense for the author, the human author, because it would have been like a football dome. It would have been across a flat space.
Interesting. So you're saying that Moses in particular, since he's the guy that wrote Moses, he thought that the world was flat?
Well, I mean, as far as I know, because it doesn't actually say that it's round, technically speaking, so he could have misunderstood that. I don't know what he thought personally, but the world seemed to think that for a while.
The world in general, you mean like the ancients and stuff?
Yeah.
I see where you're going here. I see what you're saying, because now that you mention it, Moses was adopted by the Egyptians, and their
depiction of the world definitely looked like there was some kind of warming, like bent over the earth. So,
yeah.
And,
yeah.
Funny enough, he was adopted by by the Pharaoh's daughter.
Yep.
So, with that being said, man, let's two more minutes.
Sure.
Let's fast forward, right? Maybe a couple thousand years. Within the topic of the Catholic Church, you are a priest yourself. I don't know how long you've been practicing or anything like that.
7 years.
Good, good, good. It's a good number, man. Do you know anything about Nicholas Copernicus, his involvement with the church?
A little bit. I know I studied it more in detail in seminary. I'm a little rusty on my details, but in general, yeah, I know about him.
Okay. And what exactly was his involvement, if you don't mind sharing what you know, his involvement with the church and his influences with his, I guess, publications?
Sure. You know, I don't remember what his position was or what his profession was. I don't think he was a priest, but he might have been. The church always was a body of intellectual thought. And so, as opposed to what people think nowadays, we really are opposed to science. So he was a scientist as well. And he was exploring through astronomy the universe and trying to understand the universe, basically. And so he began to think that the world was round. Excuse me. He began to think that the world rotated around the sun rather than vice versa. And he had some calculations he got from his astronomical observations that lent in that direction, but he wasn't completely sure. So I think, as I recall, the church said, since you can't completely prove it, let's stick with what we've always gone with until it can be proven, if it can be proven. That's like a Cliff Notes version of what I remember. There's way more to it, I'm sure. But that was the general story.
And I guess to pivot back to what you said about what they've always gone with, that was the idea of geocentrism, correct?
Right, yes.
Mm-hmm. Hmm. And they were basing that, correct me if I'm wrong, the church was basing that depiction of the cosmos on the Bible and their interpretation
mm-hmm.
on the Bible. Okay.
Yeah, basically.
Interesting. Well, man, like I said, I definitely didn't want to take up too much of your time. You've been tremendous help this morning, so.
Sure, I'm glad I could help.
Yeah, man. Well, hey, I hope you have a great day, and maybe we can chat again someday, right?
All right. Sounds good. Thank you.
All right, brother.
Have a blessed day.
You too.
Bye.
What about, all right, last thing, I guess, because I could go on for hours just asking you questions. It's awesome. You sound like an encyclopedia almost. But what about I guess, ancient Hebrew cosmology? I mean, how did the ancient Hebrews depict the earth and the heavens above? From my understanding, Genesis was written by the ancient, you know, Hebrews.
Well, sure. I think there was an understanding, and if you read Genesis literally, if you read the creation story, the very, very first chapter, it talks about upper waters and lower waters. And I think cosmologically, they understood that we're on the earth. They understood that the sky was essentially a dome. And on the dome were, you know, affixed the sun and the moon, and there were gates of heaven. So there was this image of, you know, massive gates to the east and massive gates to the west, and God literally rolling the orbs across the sky. Above the dome of the sky were heavenly waters, the upper waters, and they were essentially gates in the dome of the sky, which is why when you read the Noah story, it says, you know, God opened the gates of heaven. I think the ancients were actually looking at that literally, that there were upper waters that the dome was keeping back, and when God opened up the gates of heaven, the waters flooded down. They also believe that there were lower waters, waters below the earth, and of course that makes sense. If you think of an ancient desert people, what did they do to find water? They would dig, they would create wells, and they would find water underneath. So there was this understanding of upper waters and lower waters in terms of the heaven, and then the sky itself, the Hebrew word is rakia. It was understood as a dome. And they were actually pretty good at predicting movements of stars, and they were pretty good at predicting moon phases and sun phases and things like that, obviously, because they were an ancient agrarian society, and when your livelihood depends on your crops, you get pretty good at reading, you know, what's going to happen from season to season. So they knew of the solstices, and they knew of the equinoxes and things like that.
There is a crisis in cosmology. Usually in science, if we're off by a factor of 2 or a factor of 10, we call that horrible. We say something's wrong with the theory. We're off by a factor of 10. However, in cosmology, we're off by a factor of 10 to the 120. That is one with 120 zeros after it. This is the largest mismatch between theory and experiment in the history of science.
Hello?
Hi, can I speak to the pastor, please?
Yes, this is the pastor.
Hey, how's it going?
Hey, I'm good. Who's this?
This is Nathaniel. We haven't spoken before, have we?
No, I don't think... Which church are you calling for? Because my phone number's on my old church, too, I think, still.
I was actually just calling to speak to a pastor. It's remarkable that a pastor answered the phone. You mind?
Oh, well... Yeah, no, I got time. What can I do for you? I don't think we've ever talked before.
Okay, great. Well, I definitely don't want to take up too much of your time. I've just got a question. So, you know, I'm a follower of Christ, and, you know, I've been reading Genesis a lot lately, and mm-hmm. there's a word that's kind of sticking out to me, Pastor, and that is the firmament. Now, do you happen to know the biblical definition of the firmament? Because it's kind of giving me a stumbling block.
Yeah, point. No, that's an entry, because that's one of those older words we don't really use anymore. It basically just means earth, you know, the ground we walk upon. Firmament just is I don't have a definition in front of me, so that's why I'm stumbling. But my understanding of it is it just means earth itself was known as the firmament or firmament. So you know, nature all around us. Does that make sense?
Yes. It does. It definitely does, especially considering it says that, you know, there's water above and below the firmament. So if the firmament is the earth, that definitely makes sense.
Yeah, and you'll, in a few of the older hymns and some of our hymnals, you'll see that word occasionally. So that's what that means. But I'm just curious, how'd you find my phone number? Because I don't know you, do I?
No, actually, I literally Googled it.
Well, I'm glad to be of help, and if do you have any other questions I can help with?
Yeah, man. I guess piggybacking off of firmament being the earth, how would you explain the two great lights being in the firmament? Because it does state that the sun and the moon are in the firmament.
Now that's interesting, because it's been a do you know what verse that is? Is that in front of you?
Yeah, it's actually right in the first couple of verses in chapter 1, starting at verse 6, and then down it starts at verse 14 when it states that there's lights in the firmament.
Here, let me look, because I actually had a... So are you using the King James Version?
Yes, sir. That's the one that I subscribe to.
Okay, good. That's fine. I have a different translation. So mine actually, and I guess this is just a modern interpretation of a firmament, so you take what this is, or take it for what it is, but mine says dome, that we're under the dome from the waters that were above. Let there be lights in the dome of the sky to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs and seasons for days and years. Lights in the, that's an interesting one. Now, I wonder, and this is just me thinking, I've never actually had anyone ask me this part before. Do you think, I got to imagine they didn't, you know, the writers didn't really understand space, right, at that time? You know what I'm saying? So maybe they took it as the lights were up in the sky when really they're outside the earth. Does that make any sense at all?
Definitely. It may not. If they're saying that the sun and the moon are in the sky. So yours says dome.
And I don't really know why it says, I guess a dome is in a sense the shape of, well, half the earth at least, you know.
Yeah, that still doesn't narrow it down as to why the sun and the moon would be.
No, not at all. Here, let me, because I have a study Bible in front of me. If you got a second, I'll check to see if it speaks to that. All right, so I'm just going to read it for what it says, and this is for verses 6 through 8. The little commentary says, a pre-scientific understanding of the universe pictured a domed canopy, so that's where the dome comes from, I guess, or a multi-layered sky supported by mountains and so on. The sun, moon, and stars were thought to cross this dome in regular patterns, and the water was held in chambers above the dome from which it occasionally fell in rainfall. That's interesting. So I guess it's talking about, you know, before we really understood what the earth looked like, the fact that it was, you know, a huge ball, right? I think it's saying the ancient biblical writers, they described it to the best of their possible ability. So the dome, their understanding of it was just kind of a dome that lights flash through. Does that make sense?
To an extent. So the writers, excuse me. So the writers, they were basically writing on their own interpretations rather than God's.
I wouldn't say that. I would say you ever studied the Book of Revelation?
You know, I've never really studied the Book of Revelation.
This may not make a whole lot of sense, but in the, you know, there's a lot of weird sounding stuff in that book, right? And the way I've had it explained to me before, I'm a Methodist, but one of my mentors was a Southern Baptist pastor, and the way he explained it to me was that a lot of the stuff in the Book of Revelation doesn't make sense to us because it's how the biblical writers were describing things. So like a lot of what John saw when he wrote the Book of Revelation, he didn't know how to explain because he was looking into the future in a sense. God was taking him to the future. And the Book of Revelation, John wrote down descriptions to the best of his ability. So there's references, I think, to dragons spitting out fire, right, in the Book of Revelation. Well, some people believe that's John trying to interpret what he saw, meaning like a tank shooting out fire, you know, at the end times. You take that for what you will, but what I'm trying to say is that the biblical writers, they were obviously inspired by God, and these are his words to them. So it's all in terms of when this was written. Do you get a little bit of what I'm saying, at least?
Slightly, yeah. You know, I guess what I take from what you've said thus far is be wary of how you interpret the writers of particularly creation, Genesis, because they didn't know. So they were just, wrong, but incorrect, which is interesting because obviously we know that there's no dome over the
right. earth. And it's not even, and I get what you're saying, it's not even necessary that they were incorrect, but that's, in a sense it's they're incorrect, but that's what they knew is truth at that time. And that's not, you know, that doesn't take away from the fundamental truth of God's word or anything. It's just at that time you know, how could they know what the world looked like? Because when, you know, you look up in the sky, it looks like a, you know, from first glance, if we didn't know what it was, it looks like a dome, right? So, I and it's not that they can't be trusted. It's more we just have to understand when they were writing.
So once we understand their depictions, I guess, of the Earth and the depiction of a firmament, how does that then, transform or change the way we read and interpret and...
And it really, you know, when it comes down to it, it really shouldn't change it. It's just, you know, making things a little clearer in terms of, because fundamentally the fact that it's not a dome, you know, that doesn't change the message of what creation was all about, or in the end doesn't change the message of what the Bible is for us.
Wouldn't a you know, just thinking off the top of my my dome here. So wouldn't a world intelligently designed and enclosed beneath heavenly waters be a little bit more special than a ball hurtling in the middle of nowhere in which its inhabitants evolved from monkeys? Wouldn't that creation narrative and depiction be a little more revolutionary to one's conscience of God and recognition of the Creator?
Absolutely. And I'm, you know, and please don't take me as saying that, you know, we are in fact a ball, but that's how we, the Earth was created by God. And I think the fact that, you know, that we see His hand in all of creation, right, that I think that fundamentally makes life even more special, because it teaches us that God, and this is what I would think, or what I believe too, that, you know, God's hand was even in the littlest things of creation, right? That He formed us, that we didn't just, you know, the reason you and I are the way we are is not because we were formed out of apes, right? But that because God, you know, God for each one of us created us, and we're not made out of some mold, you know, like at a factory and assembly line, but God had His hand in each and every one of our creations, that we didn't just evolve out of something that's not really special in the scheme of things.
Right. So, all right. So last note here. So
yeah,
you've helped me out tremendously. So the writers of the Old Testament, they wrote depicting an enclosed earth.
Yes. Yeah.
With heavenly waters above it.
Mm-hmm.
And the sun and the moon are within the dome.
Yes.
And that was simply due to their time. They didn't understand science yet.
I mean, you know, to a point, they definitely didn't. And I mean, we look at any ancient society, and it's the same thing, you know. But yeah, they just didn't have some of the knowledge that we have today in terms of science.
Would you say that the Holy Ghost and the Spirit of God, would you say that if there were a chance for them to be inspired to write our modern depiction, mm-hmm. do you think that if that were the reality, modern depiction, do you think that the Holy Ghost and God wouldn't have disclosed it with the ancient writers due to their inability to comprehend?
I think that's a very good way of looking at it, because, you know, granted, we've gotten some stuff wrong in our society for sure, but I think we've learned a lot more, and we've learned so much that it'd probably, you know, not physically, but it would blow these ancient writers' minds. And I think, you know, and this is what I believe, is that God, you know, God got the message through that He wanted to get through, that He created man and woman for something special. But, you know, just because the writers inaccurately depicted what the earth is, that doesn't actually take away from the story. So that wasn't, you know, I'm trying to think of how to say this, because this is a difficult thing to figure out. But I would say God, you know, let that be in there because that shouldn't affect our view of the story. Does that make any sense? That his message in its fullest extent was still proclaimed. So even though, you know, the writers may have not gotten the form of the earth completely right, they still told the creation story right.
Definitely.
Okay. Definitely. Good.
Man, you know, I appreciate all your time and all your effort and your patience, man. I appreciate it, stellar. And I'm actually gonna head out now. But
okay. Well, hey, man. Anytime. Where you live around? Are you you in Georgia?
I'm actually in South Carolina, so I'm not too far from you.
Well, if you ever see, I think you may have the old phone number from my old church in Franklin County. But if you ever ever come down to Clarksville in the next couple months, come visit one of my churches if you can. I'd love to meet you. But if you ever need any help again, seriously, I love talking to people about this stuff. So call me anytime.
Yeah, man, and thank you so very much.
The Renaissance, the most innovative and hardest to spell period in history. During this era, extraordinary scientific minds broke free from the chains of ignorance. Minds like that of Nicholas Copernicus, who redefined our understanding of the solar system in a flash of inspiration.
Actually, Eureka! We aren't at the center of the universe. The Earth revolves around the sun!
Copernicus bravely published his theory, despite the inevitable wrath he'd faced from the Catholic Church.
Copernicus, we're here to burn you alive! I shall not be silenced!
Sorry, wrong again. Copernicus himself didn't face any opposition from the Church because he worked for the Catholic Church his entire life.
Wait, seriously?
Copernicus, how's your work going, you old church bureaucrat?
Finished early, boss. In fact, I've been working on my astronomy. I have this new theory I'm calling...
Don't care!
Well, maybe they didn't care at first, but when he published his book, they saw the danger it posed to their theology and they burned him alive, probably. Right?
Nope. In fact, the book barely showed up on the church's radar.
Your Holiness, Copernicus's new book says the Earth revolves around the sun.
Who cares? I'm trying to figure out the miracle of how Jesus turned water into wine.
But he dedicated the book to you.
Oh, what a sweetheart.
Copernicus dedicated his book to the Pope?
Yep. In fact, the church was so tolerant of Copernicus's ideas that some of his writings were even taught and read at major Catholic universities.
Welcome to Not Blasphemy 101. Today we'll be talking about someone the church has absolutely no problem with, Copernicus.
It was actually fundamentalist Protestants who eventually rejected Copernicus because his work contradicted passages in the Bible.
Want to know about astronomy? Check the Bible. Why can't you fart in church? Bible. Does Copernicus suck? The Bible says yes.
And when the Catholic Church saw how the Protestants were gaining influence, they started to get worried.
No one wants to be Catholic anymore. What do they have that we don't? Cronuts?
Maybe we gotta switch gears on this whole tolerating science thing.
And when Galileo started looking through his telescope, adding his observations to Copernicus's theory, that's when the church really freaked out.
Now this guy is starting with a telescope? That's it! Let's hate science 10 times more than the Protestants ever did!
So the Catholic Church turned from tolerance to suppression, rejecting Copernicus's theory and banning his book.
This class is now Blasphemy 101. Please take out your textbook and throw it in the fire.
Good morning, St. Anthony and Our Lady of the Hills. May I help you?
Good morning. Can I speak to the priest, please?
May I ask you calling, please?
Yes, ma'am. This is Nathaniel. I'm sorry.
Okay. I don't know if he's here or not. I will transfer you up to his phone. And you can leave a message if he doesn't answer.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hello, good morning.
Hello?
Hello. Yes, from the PGA, George.
Good morning, good morning. This is Nathaniel. How are you doing?
I didn't get... Pardon me?
This is Nathaniel. How are you doing?
Yes, I'm very good. Yes, sir. How are you?
Okay, good. Well, I don't want to take up too much of your time.
Yeah.
I just had a question about my Bible. It's in Genesis. I'm going to just go ahead and dive right into it, sir. It says in Genesis chapter 1, verse 6, it says, "Then God said, let there be a dome in the middle of the waters to separate one body of water from the other." And then in verse 7, it goes on to say that God made the dome, and it separated the water below the dome from the water above the dome. What is the Bible referring to? Because when I think of dome, I think of a football stadium.
Oh, okay. Genesis. Just tell me the words, please.
Yes. Genesis chapter 1, verse 6.
Okay, there's a dome. Okay, next to the waters. And the waters. Okay, no, then again it says, and it was so, then God called the dome sky, and there was evening, and there was morning. So God called the dome sky.
So the sky's a dome.
Yeah, the Bible says it's like that.
Hmm. And what does a dome mean to you? I don't mean to be frank, but when I think of dome, like I said, I'm thinking about like an enclosed environment.
Okay. Okay, but the Bible says it, right? It's sky, because, you know, God called the dome sky. Yeah, other than that, I don't know. So we can give the explanation as well. We understand it, but, you know, God created the sky. Something above the earth.
All right. So it does say that there's water above the dome, but then if you look, I don't want to take up too much more of your time, but in verse 14, in the same chapter, it says, "Then God said, let there be lights in the dome of the sky to separate day from night." So God put the sun and the moon inside the dome.
Not inside. It is the sky.
So it's outside the dome.
Yep.
Hmm. So it's outside the dome, beyond the water, above the dome.
Yeah, because if it is dome is sky, so God created moon and light, everything in the sky.
Mm-hmm. So are the stars in the dome, or are they
in the sky?
Mm.
Because dome means sky, so God created all those things in the sky.
Hmm.
Yeah.
So God put a dome in the middle of the waters, and then he put the sun, moon, and stars outside of the dome beyond the water.
Yep.
So all the light from the sun, the moon, and the stars are shining through the water and then through the dome.
Yeah, from the sky.
Hmm. Mm.
Yeah.
So what does it mean by water above the dome? Because it says there's water above the dome.
Water above?
Mm-hmm.
Let the night and dome, the sky and separate night and... Sky above the water. As we see now. It's just like that. Let the waters under the sky be gathered together into one place. Yeah. So the sky is not above now. You see now, it's above the water.
Well, I, I'm understanding that the water below the dome is the water on the earth. It's the water on
yeah,
the earth.
Below the sky. Yeah,
right.
Below the sky.
Right.
Yeah.
So what's the water above the dome?
What does it say? Less than above.
All right, so going back to Genesis chapter 1, verse 6 and 7, let's start at 7. God made the dome and separated the water below the dome from the water above the dome. So it's indicating and it's telling us that there's water above the dome.
Come and the midst of the water. Separate the water. Dome, separate the waters that were under the dome. Above, so God made the dome and separated the waters that were under the dome from the waters that were above the dome. Oh. This is your doubt, no? Why there is water above and under the dome.
You said this is my doubt?
Yeah, is it a doubt?
It's not necessarily doubt.
Uh-huh.
I take the word of God as the uh-huh. inerrant word of God. It's just, I'm trying to visualize there being uh-huh. a dome above the earth uh-huh. with, like, water above it and the sun and the moon inside the dome. That's what the Bible is describing. I'm trying to visualize that. And I figured uh-huh. you'd be the best person to call and talk to uh-huh. about this, but you seem a little unsure as to...
Yeah, this is okay. It's a good wait. Can you call me maybe after some time? I'll just check my books. We'll see then.
Absolutely.
Okay.
I appreciate it.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.